All right, everyone, good morning.
Welcome to day three on the road less traveled. And to start off this morning, we have Gabriel Bugosi, now of LAMSAD with the University of Paris Dauphine. And she is going to talk to us about logic in group decision.
Okay.
Take it away.
Thank you. So thank you, Jim, and thank you, Rafal, for the invitation. What I'm going to talk about is a problem in group decision making, but it's a particular type of problem. I know some of you know it already a bit about judgment aggregation, so that will be the main topic of the talk. So what is particular about this judgment aggregation problem? What is particular is that people not only have to decide whether they go left and right, for example, but they also have to give reasons for their decision. So that's what distinguishes judgment aggregation from general group decision making. And in fact, I have this funny picture because this problem was discovered, in fact, in law. So there are Kornhauser and Sager who discovered that actually in American courts there were decisions made by three judges, for example. So they had to make decision about the liability of a person, depending, of course, on the law. And they made this decision individually on the several issues in the law in a rational way. But the problem was that when they wanted to, let's say, to merge the individual decision to make a court decision, they realized that there were some problems in the sense that the group could be irrational. So they couldn't make a decision according to the law. Why it's important to make to justify decisions, but often a justification is the basis for a legitimate decision. Like, for example, we all remember the decision to invade Iraq was based on the idea that the claim that there were weapons of mass destruction. So it's important to give reasons for decision. Of course, this is also the case in a court decision where you cannot say to someone, well, you go to jail, you have to provide reasons. And especially sometimes these reasons will be used later for later decisions. Okay, so I said in judgment aggregation, the group needs to give, to take a decision and to give reasons for the decision. There is another component in judgment aggregation, which is the propositions are logically interconnected. And to give you a very simple example of why the problem is not trivial, let's consider an example that has been made in judgment aggregation. Suppose that there is a proposition P that says that current CO2 emissions lead to global warming. There is another proposition that says P implies Q. If current CO2 emissions lead to global warming, then we should reduce the CO2 emissions. And Q, we should reduce CO2 emissions. So suppose that there are three countries have to decide about these issues. So P, P implies Q, Q. These are the individual the decisions by each country. And then, okay, how do you make a collective decision? Well, the standard or the one of the most intuitive way is, we look at each proposition and we look if there is a majority on each proposition. So here you get that there is a majority for P, a majority for P implies Q, and a majority for Q. But of course, this is this leads to problem because the group is irrational, I mean, from a logical point of view. So, how to model this problem, how to what kind of approaches can we have? So in the first part of the talk, I will talk about three main approaches that have been done so far for in judgment aggregation. And the question will be if they are satisfactory. My answer will be for the first two, not really. And I propose a third way that I think it can be the right way to tackle judgment aggregation. Of course, I don't mean by this that there is only one approach or only one model. Huh? This is another. In fact, this is the original example of paradox in judgment aggregation. It's called the doctrinal paradox or discursive dilemma. So this was the court decision. So P and Q are called the premises, and R is called the conclusion, where P is there was a valid contract, Q is the defendant was in breach of the contract, and R is, then the defendant is liable. And the law can be represented as P and Q, even only if R. So again, similar as in the CO2 example, you see that each judge is logically consistent. And then when you do majority or proposition-wise majority voting, you get 1-1-0, which is not possible because you will get that. So there is a majority of the judges who think that the person is not liable, but in fact there is a majority who think that the reasons for being declared liable apply. So what do you do in that case? You could say either you vote by on the premises only, or you vote on the conclusion only. So either you ask people to vote only on P and Q, and then you derive the decision about the liability from the majority voting on the premises, in which in this case the person will be sent to prison or will be declared liable. Or you ask people to declare only their vote on the conclusion, so whether the person is liable or not, and in that case the person will not be declared liable. Of course, it's a way to avoid the paradox, but of course the problem is how you decide whether to go premise-based conclusion or premise-based procedure or conclusion-based procedure, given that when there is a paradox, the result is opposite. If there are questions, I don't mind to be interrupted, so feel free to. Yes?
I'm wondering, the distinction between premises and conclusion is also not clear.
Yes, absolutely.
You always have premises for premises and so on.
Yeah, that's a good point. In judgment aggregation, it's assumed that an agenda is given, and the agenda are the set of premises and also that the relation between, the set of propositions, so all the propositions on which the individuals have to cast their vote and the relation between them. So the distinction between premises and conclusion is often not clear. That's correct. And of course, you can also wonder, okay, if someone makes a distinction between premises and conclusion, then he has a high power of eventually manipulate the result. But that can be said also about the agenda. In fact, there is a work on to show that you can have a logically equivalent agenda with different results. So you could manipulate already in setting the agenda. So this paradox shows that if you do proposition-wise majority voting, then you can have a paradox or a dilemma if you take this dilemma between premises and conclusion. But the problem is more general than that. It's not only that proposition-wise majority voting has this problem, because then, majority voting has some nice properties and features, but maybe we could turn to another aggregation procedure. Well, the problem is that any aggregation procedures that satisfy some desirable properties, which are these ones, can lead to paradoxical outcomes. And of course, here I put the picture of Kenneth Arrow because, in fact, this is one of the many, I should say, impossibility results in judgment aggregation. And if you know Arrow's theorem, you will recognize that, in fact, these are translations of the properties in Arrow's theorem, so for preference aggregation, into the domain of judgment aggregation. So basically, this impossibility theorem says that whenever you have an aggregation function that satisfies universal domain, so it means you have to accept any individual judgment that is logically consistent. Collective rationality means you want an aggregation rules that gives a consistent collective decision. Anonymity, you don't want to give higher priority to some individuals with respect to others, so everybody is the same. And independence of irrelevant alternatives means, in fact, that means that the decision on each proposition, so the collective decision on each proposition depends only on the individual decisions on that proposition. So the individual decision on P depends only on the individual votes on P, not on Q and R, because that's the idea of irrelevant alternatives. The other issues are taken to be irrelevant. At the beginning, in judgment aggregation, there was really this, it's an aggregation problem. So the first models were basically to look at preference aggregation, so in social choice theory, where you have individual preferences or voting theory, and you want to aggregate and to get a collective preference. So to look at this domain and look at the properties that have been imposed and studied there and see, translate them in judgment aggregation and see what happened. And as I said, several impossibility results have been obtained in this way. In preference aggregation, in fact, there is a famous paradox. In fact, it's the first voting paradox, it's the Condorcet paradox. So what happened was that in 1770, the Marquis de Condorcet said, okay, we need to make a group decision about some individual preferences. So suppose that you have the three people there and each has these preferences. The method he proposed was a pairwise majority. So you looked at how many people prefer X to Y, well, two people over three, so there is a majority for it. So the collective will have that X is preferred to Y. There are two people also prefer Y to Z, so you put it at the collective level. And there are also two people who prefer Z to X. The problem is that you get a cycle. X is preferred to Y is preferred to Z, Z is preferred to X, so it's not clear who is the winning candidate. As I said, judgment aggregation has been studied with ideas and intuition coming from preference aggregation. So the doctrinal paradox, the paradox I showed you at the beginning, has been linked to the Condorcet paradox. The conditions of Arrow's theorem have been used to show other impossibility results in judgment aggregation. And at some point in the social choice theory, there was a bit the idea that, okay, what is this judgment aggregation at the end? I mean, it's just a social choice theory. It's just preference aggregation. In fact, the two domains are equivalent. The feeling was that there was a bit of, not attention, but a bit of, they are discovering hot water again, these guys. So a quite important result was by Christian List and Franz Dietrich, who actually showed that Arrow's theorem can be derived as a corollary from one of the impossibility results of preference aggregation. So actually they say, well, it's not really the case that judgment aggregation is just preference aggregation. It's maybe, in fact, we can claim the opposite, that judgment aggregation is more general than preference aggregation because we can derive Arrow's theorem from one of the impossibility results in judgment aggregation. Well, my position is a bit that all this reframing judgment aggregation using some idea, intuition, conditions coming from preference aggregation has been very, very fruitful. It's clear. However, I think that they are two different problems, and even if we can find some relations between the two frameworks, that doesn't mean that the frameworks are equivalent or necessarily that one is more general than the other. On the most trivial level, we can say that preferences and judgments are not the same thing. You can say that you prefer beer to wine, but when you have to make a judgment about some proposition, so you have to say if you think that proposition is true or false, you are in a different domain. So that was already a point made by Kornhauser and Sager. They say, well, the difference is that in preferences you can disagree. There is no problem. But when you talk about judgment, and especially if you are talking, like, for example, of court judgments, then there is this idea that there is an objective truth. So you want to get to the real, to the good decision, not just putting together individual preferences. And of course, the other distinction is that in social choice theory, you don't have the idea of defining collectively endorsed beliefs on logically interconnected propositions. So what is the distinction between judgment aggregation from other decision problems? Well, one could say is preference aggregation plus some logic. There is this logic ingredient. There is propositions are logically interrelated. Yes, it's true. One can also put the problem a bit differently, not for all judgment aggregation problems, but for a big class of it. In fact, this was a point raised by David Mathison. You could say that, in fact, when you take a vote on some compound Boolean proposition, the question is at what level you do this aggregation. You take it at the elementary level, at the compound level, or maybe somewhere in between. The point here is that if you think about, again, the P and Q, if and only if R, the problem is that the commutativity doesn't hold. Because if you do the majority on each proposition, like P and Q, and then you apply F is the way the propositions are aggregated, then you will get one as a outcome. But if you do the aggregation, let's say on the on the horizontal line, and then you do the aggregation, then you get a different result. So you don't have this commutativity. Another question is the independence of irrelevant alternatives that is problematic. As I said, the independence of irrelevant alternatives means that the collective decision on each proposition depends only on the individual decision on that proposition and not on other propositions. And now, given that I said that the judgment aggregation, the propositions are logically connected, the question was raised in the literature why this independence of irrelevant alternatives is questionable, because if the issues are logically connected, how can you say that they are irrelevant to each other? So one approach that doesn't satisfy, in fact, these independence conditions is the distance-based procedure, and that's the second type of approach I would like to talk about in judgment aggregation. Will be very quick. The distance-based procedures, in fact, come from computer science. So you can see there is this judgment aggregation problem, and there are some methods coming from political science, some methods coming from computer science. What is the intuition? Well, the intuition is very simple. It's something that has been studied, as I say, computer science is called belief merging. It's a, if you know, belief revision is an extension, of course, of belief revision. And the idea is that you have individual bases and you want to aggregate them. So the similarities between the two fields seem quite natural. I mean, they are doing both aggregation on some propositions. And what is the intuition? The intuition is that, in belief merging, you can have several approaches. So distance-based approach is one particular approach to the belief merging problem. The intuition in distance space is that you want to minimize the distance, so you want to find the set of propositions that minimize the distance to all the individual judgments. What is the advantage of this method? That you are sure that you get a consistent outcome. Why? Because in fact one applies the notion of integrity constraints, which is you basically say, well, the outcome has to satisfy, for example, P and Q if and only if R. So in fact, you don't look at you want to find a solution that minimizes the distances to the individual decision only among the possible only among the outcomes that you allow. So only about the outcome that satisfy the rules. So you impose this integrity constraint. So of course you don't get any paradox. It's avoided in that way. One way to do this minimization of the distances is to take a Hamming distance. I mean, this is has been widely used in belief revision already and then in belief merging. But in fact, so people who study these approaches are particularly Sebastian Konieczny and Pino Peres, they gave some postulates for the majority voting on using distance-based procedure. And in fact, then later they showed that you can use any other distance, so it doesn't depend on the particular choice of the Hamming distance. But Hamming distance is very intuitive. It just counts the number of propositions on which two individual judgments differ. So if you want, in fact, this minimal distance is a bit, you get kind of compromise solution. You get something in between. To give you just an idea of what it looks like, so the idea is that here you put all the outcomes that you allow, so the outcomes that satisfy the P and Q, not the far in this case. Then you calculate the distances between each possible outcome and each individual judgment set. So in this case, zero means that J1 was in fact PQR. And then, for example, you take the sum of these distances, you minimize, so you find that in this case, there are three possible solutions for the problem. And that, of course, is the problem of this approach is that, okay, you can ensure that you won't get a paradox. On the other side, you can have ties. And in fact, in this case, it's particularly bad because, in fact, the ties are exactly between all the individual judgments. So basically, you say, well, either you follow judgment one, the judge one, or you follow judge two, or you follow judge three. Right. One can say, well, in fact, you have a tie because, in fact, the dilemma signals that there is a lack of a clear position of the individuals, or, in fact, there are different coalitions supporting the same conclusion, which is, in fact, the case in the paradox. But the other problem is that if you looked at it, in fact, the logical part disappeared, because what you're looking at is you really have vectors of like here. When you do the distance-based procedure, you just have vectors. You have vectors of 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, and you say which vectors are allowed and which vectors are not allowed. So the logic part is considered when you talk about the integrity constraint, but in fact you don't see it there. So it's really logic, but then one can also say it is really the logic part, the source of the problem. What happens, for example, if you have independent issues? Well, there is a nice paradox in social choice theory, which is the multiple election paradox. And the point here is that there are issues that are logically independent. So suppose that there are three voters here who have to decide on three propositions, P, Q, R, call them however you want. And the point here is that any combination of zeros and ones is allowed because the issues are completely independent. So why would be this a paradox? Because then suppose you again you apply this majority voting, you get 1-1-1. Well, this is could be seen as a unpleasant outcome because in fact nobody voted for 1-1-1 in the group. So the combination 1-1-1 received zero votes in the group. So you have to accept it because we said the issues are logically independent. So you have no reason to reject this 1-1-1. On the other side, you can question, well, is it really, does this mirror the will of the electorate, let's say, the will of the people that maybe they had some reason to say not to accept all three issues? Yeah?
Yeah, but then it seems that you're talking about the proposition, all three or one.
Say
it seems
again.
That you, if that would matter, then you would be talking about the fourth proposition,
yeah.
Maybe, or all three.
Yeah, yeah, but still, one could ask. I mean, it's not clearly a paradox in the sense of the judgment aggregation. There is no violation because there is no fourth given rule that says that you can't accept all three of them. On the other side, this was raised in the literature as well, could be problematic because in fact nobody said 1-1-1. So one could ask, should we do some aggregation on each proposition, or should we, for example, another way could be to count how many people voted for 1110, so look at the combination and then go for. So at least the question is, there are still two methods, and maybe we could ask if there is a reason to prefer one to the other. Okay. Of course, the interest part for me here is that you could have a kind of multiple election paradox in judgment aggregation. You could have a judgment, a collective decisions that is acceptable from the point of view of the logical relations, but still nobody voted for. So you could have the same question in judgment aggregation. So I think at the bottom line, in fact, the point is that it's not clear what is the notion of collective rationality we have here. I mean, there is this assumption that if the majority believes, or actually if the majority supports a certain proposition P, then the group should believe P. And another assumption that is commonly made is that the group should believe whatever is logically implied by the proposition supported by the majority. In fact, the question of what kind of collective rationality intuition we have here was a criticism raised by Buchanan to Arrow after his impossibility result. For example, in social epistemologies, there are two notions of group belief, what is called the summative and non-summative view. So basically, the summative says, well, a group believe a certain proposition P, if and only if all or most of the people believe P, and the non-summative says, well, the group believe as something distinct from the individual belief. How do we define this distinct is the question. For example, you could say, well, often groups just take a decision and defend some position for other reasons, like the tobacco companies claim that, well, smoking is not that bad for your health, after all. So it seems to be that we need to define or to construct a notion, or maybe possibly more, several notions of collective rationality. So this we move to the third and last part of my talk, to the third kind of approach we can have to judgment aggregation, which is argumentation theory. So I think that argumentation theory can help in this challenge. So in argumentation theory, there are at least two big classes of argumentation theory. There is argumentation theory studied in philosophy, argumentation theory studied in computer science. What we talk more here is about abstract argumentation theory, so how it has been studied in computer science, in the work that started by Jung. What I like very much in argumentation theory is, well, on the one side that you have clear relations between arguments, and the other thing is that if you want, you can see there are different notions of rationality, which are the notions of semantics that are studied in abstract argumentation theory. I will mention them in a second. Just a very brief diversion is that, in fact, argumentation seems to be at the moment a very hot topic in different disciplines. I was last week in Amsterdam for a workshop. It was really an interdisciplinary workshop. There were philosophers, social scientists, computer scientists. And for example, there is this tool, debate graph, available on the internet. And the idea is that to have a collaborative ideas about some public policy issues. And it has been used by the White House and other institutions. So to give you a very rough idea of how it looks like, for example, this was a map on prosperity without growth. So you can, there are some issues there. Probably you don't see it, but there are like individual and cultural change, funding the economic system and so on. And then if you click on one issue, you get another map which looks at the other topics. And so people can contribute, and the idea is that the discussion is visually organized so that you can zoom in and find what are the issues that people brought about some specific problem. Okay, but let's move to the abstract argumentation theory. So as I said, it's something that has, it's a theory that has been developed already for several years in computer science and started by the work of Jung. And what we talk here briefly is a work that has been done recently with several people, also Martin Kaminada, Pozlovesky, Yadravan, and Awad. So what's the idea? The idea is that, to use abstract argumentation theory to define some group decision problems. But the notion of collective rationality that we wanted to define is a particular one, is what we called a compatible outcome. What is a compatible outcome? Well, is an outcome that is compatible with any individual view. So the idea is that you want a group decision in such that any individual can walk out of the room and say, well, this is the group decision and reflects also my view. Of course, this is it's an approach that can be reasonably applied only to small groups of individuals, but the idea is really that any individual can defend the collective position. So what did we do here was to use abstract argumentation theory to define three operators, and these operators can guarantee a unique outcome, so you don't have ties, compatible in the sense that I've roughly defined here, but we had two definitions of what compatible could be, and rational outcome, so it's something that is not a paradox, in fact. And then if I have time, but I start doubting about it, I will mention very briefly some the study we have done of these three operators from the point of view whether they are Pareto optimal and manipulable. So what is this argumentation theory? Well, the idea is you have a graph in which you have some nodes that are the arguments. Abstract is called abstract argumentation theory because in fact you say nothing about what these arguments are. It's like propositions in logic. You take P, Q, and R, but you don't say what this P, Q, and R stays for. And you have attack relations between arguments. So for example, you can have, so AF is an argumentation framework, is given by a final set of arguments and a defeat relation or attack relation. For example, you have that argument C attacks argument B and argument B attacks argument A. So what is the question in argumentation theory is, okay, suppose that you have that this C attacks B, B attacks A. What is the position that a rational agent can take once he's exposed to such a structure, that argument C attacks B and that B attacks A? So that's the question. And in order to do this, several semantics or extensions have been defined. So that's the interesting part for me in argumentation theory, is that often when you have an argumentation framework, there are several positions that you can take. Okay, here we use a labeling approach. Labeling means that, in fact, we label each argument by either in, out, or undecided. In means basically you accept it, out you reject it, undecided means what you abstain. So, as you see, with respect to judgment aggregation, we have a third value, the abstention. You are not obliged to accept or reject any argument. So, as I said, we use this labeling approach. Basically, it's a total function that takes a set of arguments and assigns, as I say, one label to each argument. How do we assign these labels? Not that you can assign them as you like. There are some rules like in classical logic. So one says that an argument is legally in or legally accepted if and only if all the attackers are out. An argument is legally out if and only if there is at least one argument that attacks it that is in. And here are the gunfight rules, because usually people can be a bit, well, why it's not symmetric. You accept it only if all the attackers are out, but to reject it, it's enough that one attacker is in. So the gunfight rules usually works very well. The idea is if there are 10 people who are trying to kill you, it's enough that one succeeds, and then you are out or dead. But on the other side, for surviving, so to be in, you need that all the people who are trying to kill you fail. So that's the intuition one can have. Undecided, if and only if there is at least one argument that attacks it that it's also undecided, and there is no argument that attacks it that is in. Why? Because if you have one argument that attacks an argument that is in, then you're automatically out. So a very quick example, suppose that you have this structure, so A and B attack each other, B attacks C, C attacks D, D, E, and E, C. So when you have like arguments that attack each other, there are three positions that you can take, so three rational positions that you can take. Either you accept A, either you accept B, or you abstain from both. You say, well, I mean, I don't have enough evidence, I don't know, so I abstain from both. If you reject A and accept B, then B is in, so sorry, the green is in, the red is out, the gray is undecided. then B attacks C, B is in, so C is out, C is out, and it's the only attacker for D, so D can be accepted, and given that D attacks E, and it's the only attacker of E, then E is out. So you can have this first labeling. The second one, if you accept A, then you reject B. All the rest is undecided. Why? Because you cannot put C in, because if C is in, D is out. D is out, E in, but you cannot have that E and C are both accepted if one attacks each other. Because if one attacks each other, then if one is in, the other has to be out. Or you can have all undecided. Well, you take no position. You abstain from everything. Okay, so as I said, there are different semantics in argumentation theory. In this work, we focus only on three semantics. Well, there are reasons for this decision. Basically, the reason is that they are the three main semantics, and they guarantee a unique outcome. And on the other side, in these semantics, you can have different individual labelings. It's no interest of doing a group decision making if all the individuals can take the same position. I mean, it's completely uninteresting. So what are these semantics? So as I said, this idea of semantics, you can see it as different notions of rationality. So the first main, the basic semantics is conflict-free. What does conflict-free says? It says that if you have two arguments and A attacks B, for example, then you cannot accept A, sorry, it's the other way around, B defeats A. So if you accept A, you cannot accept B. So conflict-free means if one argument attacks each other, you cannot accept both of them. Admissible is a bit more demanding. It says that it's a labeling in which there are no arguments that are illegally in and there are no arguments that are illegally out. What does it mean? So if you go back to this definition, I said I gave the definition for being legally in, legally out, and legally undecided. So illegally in means it doesn't satisfy the definition of legally in, legally out, and legally undecided. So in fact, the admissible labeling means that you can accept arguments that are illegally undecided, because the only thing it says, you don't want illegally in and illegally out, but you might have illegally undecided. And then the third semantics we will look at is the complete labeling. There you say, it's again a bit more demanding, and say no, you cannot have arguments that are illegally in, illegally out, like in the admissible, and illegally undecided. So you want maximum, let's say, rationality at this point. Okay, so this is just to show that some other semantics that we didn't take into account, so we focus on these three, and the complete is an admissible, and the admissible is conflict-free, because it's really the idea of imposing more conditions on the on this rationality idea. Okay, so what are these three aggregation operators that we propose? The first one is very, very simple. Well, they are all simple, but the first one is basically a kind of unanimity, if you want. It says, well, an argument is accepted only if everybody accepted it, an argument is rejected only if everybody rejected it, and undecided in all other cases. So trivially, if you have two agents and you have A attacks B and B attacks A, suppose one agent says he accepts A, he rejects B, and the other one abstains from both, then the collective decision, so this is the skeptical operator, would abstain from both A and B. So here we have the first definition of what can be considered compatible outcome, so this idea of individuals can defend the group decision because it's not in conflict with their own position. So the first definition of this compatibility operator can be that a labeling is less or equally committed than another labeling, which we denote by this symbol, if and only if the arguments that are accepted in L1 are a subset of the arguments accepted in L2, and the same holds for the arguments that are rejected. So this means, of course, if you have a labeling which abstains from all the arguments, this is, of course, less committed than this labeling. So the white is in, the black is out, and the gray is undecided. It's less committed than this L2 and this L4. So of course, we get that the initial outcome, the initial skeptical outcome, is less or equally committed than all the individual labelings. So Li are the labelings of each individual I. Yeah. The problem is that it violates collective rationality. Why? Because if we apply this operator, we get that A and B are undecided, C is rejected, and D is accepted. And this is not admissible, well, it's not a permissible labeling for the admissible semantics, because you reject C, but you had no reason to reject C, because to be rejected means that at least one argument has to attack it. So that's a problem. So what we do is we have a second phase, which basically it's a contraction function, but the idea is simple. You just look at all the arguments that have been accepted and couldn't be accepted, you put it undecided, and so on. And we get then a final skeptical outcome, which is a unique result. It satisfies collective rationality under all the three semantics that we consider, and is less or equally committed than individual labelings. What is the problem? Well, sometimes it ignores unanimity, because, for example, here you had a unanimous vote on to reject C and to accept D. And here you would get the group who would abstain from everything. Is this a problem? Well, maybe. On the other side, one could see relations with the default logic and floating conclusions, where you have the same conclusion supported by different reasons. And for example, Jeff says that maybe it's not such a problem in refusing a unanimous decision on such floating conclusions, because the reasons are not secure enough to support this argument. Well, I don't have time to talk about the operation dilemma. I quickly move to the second operator, the credulous one. It's a bit more relaxed. He says, well, to accept an argument, it's enough that someone accepts it and nobody rejects it, so there is no strong clash between agents. So if one abstains, well, you can accept it. Second definition of compatible decision is, well, the two labelings, they have no arguments that are the intersection between the argument accepted in one labeling and the argument rejected in another labeling is empty. Of course, this initial credulous operator gives a compatible labeling. The problem is that, it violates collective rationality already under the first semantic, so the least demanding, so conflict freeness. So what we do, second phase like in the previous example, and then we get a final outcome that is unique and collective rational. What is the problem? Well, here you get collective rationality, you can guarantee collective rationality under the first two semantics, conflict-free and admissible, but not under complete semantic. Why? Because take these two examples. The credulous aggregation would have that E and F are undecided. But in fact, you have under the complete semantics, you cannot have illegally undecided arguments. And these are illegally undecided because if all the attackers are out, then you should accept E and you should reject F. So I don't have time to go through, but that's basically what we do in the third aggregation operator, the supercredulous. Basically, it's an expansion function which extends this. Again, you get the problem here that you might ignore unanimity, because here, in fact, you have unanimity for abstention on E and F. And here, in fact, you force the group to accept E and reject F. Okay, and well, I don't have time to talk about it, but just to say that then we looked at, we wanted to see if these aggregation operators were Pareto optimal. Pareto means that, in fact, you cannot improve the social outcome, so you cannot make one individual better off without making someone else worse off. And we looked at whether this if one could manipulate the collective decision. So if individuals, by knowing which procedure is used and by knowing what other people will vote, if they had an incentive to say something else than their real positions in order to get a better outcome. So I don't have time to go through this. We looked at several distances and some of the problem of strategy proof. And we also found, a quite nice idea of lie. So there is some, under some conditions you can have, yes, people can manipulate, but actually it's a nice kind of manipulation. It's what we call benevolent lie, because in fact, not only you will benefit from it, but also other people will benefit from it. Okay, conclusion. So I spoke a bit about this topic of judgment aggregation and the models, three approaches that have been used so far. I mean, of course, it was not exhaustive. So social choice theory or preference aggregation coming from economics, then belief merging coming from computer science. I said that there are problems in both approaches. I think one thing that one needs to work on is how to define one notion or possibly several notions of collective rationality. And I think that one approach that could help to study the judgment aggregation problem is argumentation theory. We are really at the beginning for extending argumentation theory to multi-agent system. This is really something weird, because it has been studied in computer science for many years, but it's really still a theory mainly for one agent or a dialogue, so you have two agents. But what is missing and what we were working on, so it's really something that people are starting looking at, is how to extend this theory to several agents. And last thing, I think that in fact what we need is there are more realistic models of collective decision making. For example, looking at deliberative models. When you sit in any committee, it's not that people say, well, I want this candidate for this and this reason, and they don't, and then you aggregate and then you go home. No, you argue, so you exchange arguments, and if you are not stubborn, you also are available to change, to revise or update your belief and adapt to other level of expertise, for example. And very last thing, if you a small advertisement, if you want to know more about judgment aggregation with Davide Grossi, we just published this book, An Introduction to Judgment Aggregation. That's it.
So, questions? Katie.
Whereas this
Yes, exactly.
Right. That three proposition paradox, where the majority votes yes on all the propositions, this is fine by the summative approach, right?
Yeah.
But you might wonder whether it's sort of a suitable holistic
yeah.
opinion.
If people will be happy to walk
yeah.
out and say, well, yeah.
So now, where does the argumentation theory fit in, or do you think it sort of helps to get a grip on both of these notions?
Oh, I was not thinking the argumentation theory to fitting necessary either in the summative or non-summative. I think what is useful in argumentation theory is that you have one question is whether we can translate any judgment aggregation problem in an argumentation framework. But what you have there is really the relations, the attack relations between different arguments. So you have that's the idea. You could represent the relations between propositions in the agenda. So like in the work that I presented at the end, the idea is that people have the same argumentation framework, so like in judgment aggregation you have the same propositions on which you have to express your opinion. They can give different judgments, so different labels to these arguments, and then you want to aggregate into a collective position. As I said, given that really the study of argumentation theory from a multi-agent perspective is really at the beginning, there is no real why we have to go summative or non-summative. But what I like is this idea of different level of rationality. You can be very little demanding, so you go like conflict-free, you just say, well, if A attacks B, you can accept both, and then impose more and more conditions. And then you could see, for example, what you can see is that maybe individuals, you can allow individuals to have different notions of rationality, and maybe at the collective level, again, another one. So you can play with this, which I think it's something interesting to look at.
More general.
Yeah.
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 I have two questions. One is clarification. In the argumentation representation, could you just say quickly what the nodes and the defeat relation are?
And the
defeat relation.
Okay. Well, the nodes, it's called abstract argumentation because it's very abstract. So the nodes are just arguments.
Your interpretation.
Yeah, okay. Here we, we also were on the abstract level, so we just say, well, they are arguments. The question is to translate eventually like an agenda judgment aggregation into an abstract argumentation framework. So then you could see an argument, instead of an argument like premises and conclusion, you could see each node as like a premise that attacks, for example, another premise and the relation with the conclusion.
So a comment?
Yeah.
I always worry about abstract argumentation, that it is too abstract. And
yes.
I always think that the issue is representing the things in the theory. So I'm wondering whether you put the arguments in as nodes and then have defeat relations in the way that, say, John Pollock would have wanted to, or whether the nodes are like propositions. And the defeat relations are logical. Have you done that? Have you actually?
No, that's something where we got a project recently, and one of the things we want to do in the project is really to look at translation of judgment aggregation into argumentation theory, and that's these are part of the questions we have to look at. So it's not done yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Second quick question. So the semantics you were looking at are sort of prior to where argumentation theory usually starts. Usually it starts with the complete semantics and specifies it further into the stable semantics.
Yes, yes,
so
yes.
I'm wondering,
yes.
Is there a reason?
Yeah, well, the reason is that The other semantics we couldn't guarantee a unique outcome, but we wanted a unique outcome. And so this for some semantics. For other semantics, there was only one labelings that could be allowed, so it's not interesting to do some collective decision making if everybody has to vote at the same. Well, it's very easy. So that's why we focused on the conflict-free, admissible, and complete.
Fabien?
Yeah, I would like to return to a very specific case you presented. When you say that in order to represent the majority decision, you have a vector, you know, with three coordinates.
So the distance-based procedure you're talking? Yeah?
It was afterwards.
Yeah.
You say the majority decision was 1-1-1, even if no one.
Ah, yes.
Really, you know?
Yeah. So the multiple.
About this, example.
Yeah, and the question is, sorry, I missed it.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
So my point is that if you have this majoritary result, according to me, it seems that it's because you have something like a sum of every vertical set of one zero bits. But what if you want to have the sum horizontally?
Yeah, exactly.
It's possible to have this case by applying coefficient to each set of different bits, and the result should be maybe more realistic in the sense that in this case you should have something like a proportional system and not a majoritary electoral system.
Exactly.
So what about the difference between two sorts of calculi, horizontally, vertically? You have different partitions for each of these calculi or situation?
Well, that was the question raised by Brahms, Kilbur, and Zwicker who actually discussed the multiple election paradox. In fact, they say, well, I mean, they were not so bold to say this is a paradox, but say at least it raised the question, and the question was exactly what you said. Either we do some aggregation on the vertical line, so we get something that, in fact, we will get the same result with distance-based merging, because proposition-wise, majority is just what you get with the minimizing the distances. So you can have this kind of compromise solution that could be something in between that, in fact, minimize the distance, but it's something that nobody put forward. Or that's the other procedure that you can look at is looking at how many votes each combination has. So for example, 011 has 4 votes, 110 has 2, so maybe we could go for 011 because there is more support for that particular combination. Yeah, and in fact, that this was a question in the paper. At least we should wonder which procedure should we go for.
What's your opinion?
Well, there are, of course, well, my opinion is that in general I'm against for one specific approach. I think that each approach has some, it depends on the kind of decision you can take. I don't think that there is one approach that you can apply in every situation and everywhere. But of course, this is raises the question. It's like in social choice theory, we need a bunch of aggregation rules, and then to study them with what kind of properties they satisfy, and then we can choose which aggregation procedure to use. Yeah.
All right, and Dieter?
A very small question. Maybe it would be interesting to have a look at the political system in Belgium. Because what you typically have there is that, you know, for example, 6 parties in the government, and they all want to score with their electorate. They want to show that, okay, we got something. And for example, sometimes you have both socialists and liberals. So you always get a kind of compromise within the government. And it is even more complex than just looking at horizontal things, because you want each of them has more and less important point, and the one of the important points to come out, even if that has the support of a minority.
Yes.
So maybe this would be an interesting, more complex and not realistic.
I think that being an Italian, I have also Italian politics. It gives me enough insight on this kind of games.
It probably was, yes. Also,
Any other questions? Then let's thank Dr. Pugosi again.
Thank you.